is the bomb.
Hey everyone, welcome to the Mabel Syndrome Podcast. My name is Jessica, and as you all know, I'm in Whistler, BC, and I'm here with my partner in crime, Kristen, who is far, far away from me, different country, different continent. Say hi, Krista.
No, Kristen. Same continent.
I called you. I called you by the wrong name in my geography stuff. So,
okay. We're starting off really strong.
Can we do it again?
No, we're not doing it again.
No, this is it. This is the thing. It's happening. This is happening as it is.
So everybody,
you said we're on different continents.
I know. I was like, what continent are you on? Are you on the African continent or Greenland? Is there a continent? Australia?
I'm in Canada. I feel super far away.
That's good stuff.
So Kristen is on the same continent. And say hi, Kristen.
I'm laughing too hard now. Like,
okay, I swear to God, I've only had one sip of my drink. So anyway, let's get started. Anyways,
okay, I'm in Boston.
What, you guys have alcohol? You have podcast juice?
Have you not seen our podcast instructions where it says we're most likely going to be drinking? We hope you are too.
Oh, I must have, like, I just read it, like, before I hopped on. But I was, like, skimming it, so I must have missed that part. But I like it. If I get home, I'm probably going to get out so I can have a drink.
Yes! That's good, awesome. Because we usually start our podcast by asking people what they're drinking. And I think
I will be drinking a cider, a Stella. A Stella nice. Cider.
Yeah. Stella has cider?
Oh, they have a great cider. It's not too, like, syrupy. It's not too dry. It's just right that good spot. Oh. And, yeah, it's good. I've been buying it pretty consistently.
What's the percentage of alcohol?
What is it, like 5.6 or something like that? It's not too bad.
That's an important factor for me.
Yes, like that is an important factor.
Like, currently I have a Caesar that I'm drinking, and then I always have loaded up just in case I run out, because I'm doing the podcast from my bedroom, is this Golden Drac beer. And it's from Belgium, and it's 10.5%. So,
important. 10.5?
Yeah.
Hey, Luke, it's a fire engine.
Oh, my God. Okay, so before we keep talking, Kristen's going to catch your breath from me completely fucking up the start of this. And we're going to introduce Shaun, because...
It's some guy.
We're just talking to someone.
There's some guy in his car. We decided to take a chance on us, which is kind of... We're
on the 405. I'm reporting here from traffic. We have an accident on the Royal Lane. It's good. No,
it's perfect.
I'm already, like, the eye in the sky.
See, it's perfect.
This is live. We'd really have you do the traffic, but it's...
Did somebody get that Simpsons reference, I hope?
I failed miserably at that. my 6-year-old would get it, though.
No, it's like, he's like, when do I get my time, Kent? He's like, this isn't the time, Artie. He's like, you're not the time.
Do you know what I think is the best part of this? Is that your wife is in the car and she can only hear your half of the conversation.
Yeah.
She's used to that.
That's awesome.
Excuse me. Getting over being sick too. Fun.
Oh no.
That's okay. We have kids. That's what happens. It's the ongoing thing.
We just put my daughter in private preschool, to get her started and stuff. Second day, like, I came down with, like, I was like, oh gosh.
Yeah.
It was just one time. Just went in there the one day, and then
you're a bit.
We should say that Shaun's in the car with his wife and his kid, and they're super cute.
It's a family affair.
Yeah, it's a family podcast.
So Shaun,
I will say that the sick thing gets better the second they go to kindergarten. It's like 5, and all of a sudden they don't get sick as much.
Well, with me, they got sick. I got sick.
Oh, she didn't get it?
She's fine.
Oh.
Just wait until she starts bringing home things like pink eye and hand, foot, and mouth disease.
Fun.
Yeah.
The other people are horrible.
Yeah, they are. It's all the other people.
Other people are the worst.
Yeah. Everybody sucks except for us. That's pretty much what the conclusion is. Right,
right, right. This is a pretty exclusive club right now.
It is. So not just a random guy in a car.
I did a thing or two, I think.
You do a thing mm-hmm. or two. So Shaun is the guy behind the director of the Fat Wreck documentary that came out last year.
November 22nd. Yeah.
November 22nd. So it's kind of a big deal you're on the show because Kristen and I, Fat Records is, you know, a huge part of both of our lives. So it's
awesome.
I actually just noticed, I don't know if you can see it because it's super faded, but I have one of my Fat Wreck cups.
Nice. It's appropriate that it's faded.
It is.
It's cooler. It's cooler than it's faded.
I'm not allowed to put them in the dishwasher.
If you had milk in there or something of a different color, you could probably see it.
Yeah.
With the brown liquor, it kind of hides it a little bit.
It's my strung out one.
Nice. So it'll be like a reveal. Like as you get more and more drunk.
It's totally what's going to happen. You've probably never heard or seen anything about us before, but that's kind of
I haven't heard the podcast, which is and I gotta be honest, I'm a podcast nerd. Like I am podcast guy. Like I have a Stitcher app on my I've been using since 2011, and it's not even as accurate because I started listening to a few podcasts that weren't on there, but at last check I had listened to 16,000 podcast episodes.
Wow. What are your favorite ones?
Oh, you're in trouble now. This is a rabbit hole. I don't know. I'll just give you the top three.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And so 99% Invisible. That's an absolute must. That's because then from there you get Radiotopia and that whole network of podcasts. Super well done, well produced. Like they tell stories of design, and the guy who runs, his name is Roman Mars. It's really amazing. Tessa, you want to talk? So that one, my current.
Just my, so it's the girl, not a thing.
Tessa.
Tessa, are you saying hello? Do you want to say hello?
Hi, Tessa.
She just wants her 15 minutes.
Tessa, we can get a juice box when we get home, sweetie.
Oh, I have another. Oh, she wants a juice box. Oh, this is great. This is great.
That's okay. I'll just drink some more vodka while you hand out that juice box.
That's good. Gotta hand out this juice box to the baby. Like, this is the best podcast ever right now, by the way.
It's actually kind of exceptional.
This is so real.
Exactly.
Well, we're both.
This is real punkers in our 30s. This is what it looks like. Are you in your 30s, Shaun?
I'm my late 30s.
Yeah, so are we. Yeah, so.
I'm 36.
Oh, so I'm the oldest one here.
Nice.
Yeah.
You have the most experience.
Totally. I'm the baby.
How old are your kiddos?
My kids are 6 and 4. I have 2 little boys.
Nice.
Yeah, they're awesome.
There's a lot of penis in her house.
Yes. And my dog and my cat are both males, and probably my goldfish. So.
Probably.
That's a lot.
I haven't checked.
A goldfish penis, for sure.
Yeah.
My wife now has no idea what's going on. Like, that is the best. Like, if you're going to do the thing, the best side of another conversation, you're like,
right.
Goldfish penis. Like, what are you even talking about right now?
Sure. Totally goldfish penis.
It didn't even faze her, though. That's she's so used to it.
We might have to hashtag goldfish penis when this gets posted.
I think that's a new band I'm starting.
I'd listen to it.
Yeah. Have you heard of this band, Goldfish Penis? A stupid name, but they're amazing.
You call them GP for short.
Yeah, but I wouldn't let you. I'd be like, GP, don't shorten it. Don't shorten my goldfish penis.
Oh my God. I hope every podcast from here on out goes this way.
Oh, it will.
This is good.
We had Danny style.
We do have Danny style.
We have something for each one.
We do. We have like a unique hashtag for everyone. What was the Bomb Pops one?
Peach Schnapps, I'd say.
Oh yeah, Peach Schnapps.
How was that one? The Bomb Pops are great.
Oh, they're so awesome. They were really fun.
I like how I had the foresight to know that they're going to be a part of that record and put them in the movie.
I was just wondering about that because I was just watching the extras today. I watched the movie a couple months ago, but I just watched some of the extras today and I saw them in it. And I was like, wait, was that put out before they were on Fat?
Mm-hmm. Wow. Well, and they were kind of circling. They were in that orbit. They had been in that orbit for a couple years. And they knew everybody, you know, all the Bad Cop. And they played with Bad Cop. And we figured it'd be good to get a perspective of someone who's in a band that's kind of just outside of it and has that kind of perspective, is not part of the family, but has, you know, wants to be part of the family and has been associated with the family. The Fat Family is what I mean. Mm-hmm. So I thought it was cool to get their perspective. And then when they got signed to Fat, I was like, great. That's really, it kind of worked out. You know, I'm glad that they were in the movie. And then I got to get their perspective. Although I think I could have given them better angles. I wish I would shouted a little better. It was like 3 a.m.
when we did the podcast with the girls, they sat in their bathroom together. So they did their podcast from the bathroom. There was no concern of angles whatsoever.
No.
I bet that sounded amazing.
Yeah, they did. we were pretty excited actually. But when I saw them, I was super excited to see them on the movie as well. And you know what? Doing a podcast with them made me love them even more. Like just getting to chat with them and get to know them.
Yeah, I like their relationship. Like they have a really great camaraderie.
Oh my god, it's awesome. Even during our podcast, I think it was Jen, she said something like, I never thought I would meet my musical soulmate when I was 13. It was like so stinking cute.
They're always finishing each other's sandwiches.
Yeah. Well, that's like, what did we say, Kristen, that like me and you are the less talented older version of them?
We're the older, frumpier, less talented Bomb Pop
version.
Yeah,
that's totally friends. What it is. Yeah.
Gosh, the ego's here. I didn't know I was going to be dealing with so much ego.
We're a little self-deprecating, if you haven't noticed.
Maybe that's awesome. That's right up my alley. That's where I operate. I feel an instant kinship.
Oh, good. See? Self-deprecating soulmates.
No, I really, I think I looked into you guys earlier, so I like what you guys are doing for sure, as far as the magazine. The website and the, but I didn't realize there was a podcast.
Well, we haven't actually released any.
No, that's smart. No, that's smart. You're supposed to bank them. You got to bank them.
That's what we're doing. Yeah.
So we're in the process of banking them and hopefully in the next few weeks getting them out because we want to make the Bomb Pops one relevant for their album release as well.
Boom.
Yeah, it's just hard getting, you know, we've had quite a few technical things going on, so it's about dialing in that side. Like, we did a couple that just were unlistenable.
Well, it's good. It's good that you guys are, like, focused on some of the production values and making sure, like, consistency, as far as I can tell, in podcasting is huge. Like, a set day, almost a set time where people know they're going to get the new one, like, on a consistent basis, so. Mm-hmm. And I know tough. I know it's tough. It can be tough. So my hat's off to you. I don't have a hat, but if I had one,
thank you. Well, we were, you know, podcasting wasn't even on our radar and it was sort of advised to us by, Danny from Face to Face. And he was like, it's super easy. And you know, this is a really great idea. And then he got into helping us and was probably like, holy shit, these girls know nothing. But he's still helping us, which is amazing.
That's great.
But we're trying to get eight backed up before we start releasing.
You guys got to get some SM7Bs.
Some what?
Do you know what that is?
No, but now you have to tell us.
Yeah.
You need to get some SM7B is a broadcast microphone. They run about $250, but they have a really tight cardioid pattern. That allows, like, you don't get any of the room noise. And it has, like, it gives you the perfect distance. I'm an audio engineer, by the way.
Okay. That's what Danny
has. So, if you're able to get a I mean, it's a you know, a little bit of investment, but your sound, your production quality is going to be really good.
What do they hook up to? Like, what do you
XLR? You're gonna have to. What are you guys recording onto right now?
We record via this website, Zoom, and then we put it into GarageBand.
Grab your tablet, honey.
Okay. Okay.
Grab it. Turn it on.
Yeah, it's not great.
So now Sean's like, right.
Well, I mean, I've been an audio engineer for 13 years. I don't expect you to know all the same things that I would know.
Or anything.
That's not fair. And I've listened to 15,000 episodes of podcasts.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
It's a little weird. Like, what's wrong, boogers? What do you need? What do you need? Oh, no. She says no. She says no. I got it. Okay. This is great. So, offline, if you guys ever need any tips, I can help you with tips and stuff as well. I gotta, you know. But besides that,
be careful what you wish for.
I know, right? Oh, what have I gone into? What have I gotten myself into now?
But you know, we've had a couple friends really help us out. So we had a friend, you know, like put together a whole intro for us, and then
that's great.
Yeah. So, and he made us look way better than we are. So, you know, we've got some good friends helping us out, which is awesome.
And so you guys are doing like the thing. And then you're kind of, you're putting it out kind of as is. You're not doing any editing yet.
Nope, no editing. This is all happening.
This is happening. This is happening right now.
On our last podcast, he was like, oh, just make sure you edit that out. We were like, yeah, nope. That's not a thing yet.
No, if you said it, it's there.
Yeah, pretty much.
Do the pre-edit, the one in your brain.
Yeah, exactly.
That's what we try to do.
Don't say anything controversial.
Yeah, right. Easier
said. All right. So I think it's awesome. I think you guys are. I think it's awesome. I think it's. I think it's a great idea to do what you're doing. And I like the whole idea of what you're doing. Like I support it 100%.
Nice.
Cool. Thanks.
That's awesome. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, we both have watched the movie and we both loved it. Oh, did we lose him?
That'd be funny if one of them hated it.
Right.
No, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I said it would be really funny if one of you really hated it.
Right. Yeah. You'd be like, I liked it. Just thought it was eh.
It was meh.
You know, part of the thing with being Mabel Syndrome that Chris and I have talked about before is we didn't want to do show reviews because we don't want to go to a show and think it sucks and then post it on our website. you know, and we don't like promote anything we don't really love. And even if one of us loves something a little more than the other, we talk about it and we go forth in a positive way. Like, we're not down with the slagging anybody or being like, hey, Kristen loved this and I thought it sucked balls. Like, just, it's not our thing. So,
yeah.
But was there anything you didn't like?
Oh, I can answer that.
I can.
All right. No, that's fine. It is what it is now. Well, so, like, I won't feel bad.
I wonder if ours is the same, Kristen.
I don't right. know.
Same
probably.
Time.
I bet it's not.
Oh, really? No.
Because I loved it. It wasn't.
Yeah, no, I loved it too.
But I can. You can love something and not like every single aspect of it. I mean, my wife loves me, but
and I'm sure she loves every single aspect of you.
I'm sure there's some aspects that she could do without.
Yeah, that's how it works.
So, Kristen, you go first. I would like to hear yours was.
Mine was just that I was expecting a little more. Like, it almost feels like it needs a part two. Right. So it just felt like it cut off, and you did such an amazing job describing the foundation of FAD and really giving a sense of what it was and why Mike and Aaron started it, and all that stuff was done beautifully. And then you just focused on I don't know how many it was, five or six bands maybe.
Yeah, it was the first five.
The first five.
They basically established the sound.
It left you hungry for more.
It did. Exactly.
Well, no, that was the plan. I got all that bonus stuff that I charged for.
Right. That's a good critique.
But no, that was a great critique. I mean, that was purposefully done in a way because one, I knew from the very beginning when I started making the movie that I had to limit myself at some level.
You can't do it all, right?
Right. So I was like, and if you hear in the movie, Mike and Aaron both say it, like the lines are like, well, and you could talk about the fat record sound. They're like, well, it was really the first five fat bands. And that kept coming up over and over again. And I had already decided early on that it was going to be those five that are really the ones that established the label. Because I couldn't go into, like, all the other ones. Because I could not... I mean, even with those five bands, we spend maybe 7 minutes each band.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And that is almost half of the movie. You know what I'm saying? Like, that is, like... And another thing we had to do was we needed to make it for an audience that's not into Fat Records. So the first half of the movie is just explaining who the people are so that we can tell the story of the label at the end. So when they're talking about Lagwagon or they're talking about this particular band, you know who they are, even if you've never heard punk rock in your life. Mm-hmm. So it was really like from a structural standpoint, like laying down the foundation to it's like in a regular kind of movie, like a narrative movie where you have to establish who the characters are, their motivations, before you can actually get to the second act where you're kind of basically telling the story, you know? So you kind of have to bring people along.
I love that. That's a good explanation. Mm-hmm.
And the other thing is we wanted to keep it short because I wanted the pacing to feel like a Fat Records album, which Mike limited the most of the bands he did. He's like, don't do more than a half an hour record. Hmm. He's like, what's wrong?
What's the screaming help?
What's wrong, boogers? So I wanted it to be kind of quick, and I think I've always felt that way with, like, even bands that I see. I have this thing about opening bands. It's like, play for, like, 20 minutes.
Yeah.
And then get off stage and get people being like, whoa, that was great. We'd love to see you. When you're the headliner, you play 40 minutes. But when you're the opening band, like, so many times I go to, like, local shows, and the opening band will play like 40 minutes and they'll play like 15 songs. And it's like, even if I'm digging on them at the beginning, like by that part, it's kind of like, oh, okay.
It makes so much sense. I totally agree. Like they can start off strong and then you're like, oh, come on.
Right. And then, because it's even with other big bands when they play forever, I'm like, oh geez. That's because I'm getting jaded as I get older, which is awesome. But that was a big thing to keep it under an hour and a half. So we did it. We hit an hour and 28 minutes, and I went back and trimmed and got I spent probably like 2 or 3 months just like shading off little things, words, and just getting it tighter and getting the pacing right and getting it. I wanted it to be quick in and out, and then you're going, I've got to find out more about these bands, you know? So that's a great criticism.
Yeah. I like that. That's good. And a good explanation back. Like now I'm like, okay, yeah. So there's that makes sense. Cause that's exactly what you did.
Mm-hmm. I would say there was a lot of thought that went into everything. And there's multiple layers. There's all these little Easter eggs and references. Like in the Propagandhi interview, one of their, not Propagandhi, Jason Heller, he's a writer, and behind him when he did his interview is this VFW, you know, veterans centers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the one that he's behind, that's behind him, is where the Propagandhi riot happened. There was a riot that happened and the police came at a Propagandhi show in Denver at this place. When we're looking at, like, people who know about that would be like, oh my God, that's that thing, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And throughout the whole movie, there's lots of little references and little, like, in the interview with Ryan Green in his studio, there's a red guitar and a blue guitar. Those two guitars are on all the early Fat Records albums. That's what they were, like, all the bands recorded on those guitars. So like we set them up and lit them and like brought them in like, you know, as a little reference, you know, allusion to that thing. So yeah, so there's like a lot of, there's even an Easter egg on the Blu-ray and then DVD. There's a little Easter egg, and I don't know if I want to say it. The fact that I even said it now is like,
but now don't say what it is though. Just like,
I won't say what it is, but if you look around the menus, there's something that's extra there. And if you end up on it and you click on it, you'll get a little special treat.
Oh,
that's exciting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's
so awesome. Whenever we did, I mean, I did all the DVD authoring myself. I really did a lot of the stuff that you usually farm out to, so I could save money, really, and to learn how to do it. But I always end up doing more than I should. You know what I mean? Like going and doing, creating more work for myself. But I think it's worth it to like have those different layers. And where someone who's maybe who doesn't hear this podcast, they don't know about the Easter egg, one day accidentally clicks on it and like this thing starts playing and they're like, whoa, what's this? Like, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. Oh, it's amazing. Like, it's great, you know?
That's like the old hidden song on albums when you used to get the CD and you get the hidden song and you're like, rad, and then you go tell everyone about it and they're like, what?
That's true.
Yeah. Right.
I was listening to Green Day Dookie in my car the other day and the hidden song came on because I like the last song played and I got distracted and all of a sudden it came on and I was like, oh my God, excited again. And it was like, what did it say I saw on Facebook today or yesterday that it's been like 28 years since it was released or 26 years since it was released? And I was like, holy crap. But anyway, the secret song got me excited. So
yeah. So Shaun, in an effort to keep it down to an hour,
hello?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
I just had, so I don't know if you saw what happened just now.
No.
Like basically I got a call cause we ordered some Chinese food on like Uber Eats, like on the way. So they just called me cause we just got home and they were calling me to tell us they were here. And so I answered the phone. And then when I came back, you guys were like,
oh my God.
Oh, I didn't even know you were answering your phone. That's so funny.
It didn't make you look like you were doing anything other than just not responding to like.
Did I just freeze? Like, you're like, wow. Kinda. He was so animated before. And now, did we say something wrong?
Yeah.
We're just super used to technical problems. When we did a podcast the other night, we said hello to our guests and he couldn't hear us. So it was like, hey, welcome to the podcast. How's it going? And it was just like silence. And we just sat there looking at him, but he couldn't hear us. And I was like, wow, he's super like uncomfortable and this is going to be awkward. So that's okay. We're good.
Yeah.
So in an effort to keep it under an hour and a half, what were you going
to
say?
Okay. In an effort to keep it under an hour and a half, was there anything really good that got cut that you didn't want to cut?
Yeah, I mean, there's if you watch the bonus, you caught a lot of the stuff.
That was most of the stuff that, okay.
Anything that was really great, we kind of put in that. And because it really had to, there was stuff that we wanted to put in, it maybe wasn't corroborated enough. Because, you know, whenever we were doing the documentary thing, you want to have a story that's told from at least two or three angles, perspectives. So that it gives it a certain amount of depth and credibility, even. Because one guy just said this thing happened. It's like, okay, but if two or three people are saying it, you know, it gives a little more credibility. And also you get different perspective. So there's a few stories that just didn't really fit in with what we were trying, the story we were trying to tell per se. And there's a lot about flow. I don't know how to describe it, but the way that like things flow into each other. And so some things just didn't work in that flow as we were telling story. Like as it goes from strung out section, we flow into like the recording studio and the fat record sound, and it's kind of like this natural, it feels like they're talking about metal and how they're metal. And so anyways, just an example of that kind of thing. So there's some stuff that just got pulled out just for structurally didn't work.
So I have a question.
Good. This is amazing.
Which seems to be our go-to transition when we
I didn't call this podcast to answer questions.
Oh my gosh. Where's my drink? Hold on. Drink. Wait, I gotta have a drink. I don't know if you can.
Oh, wait. Wait, I'm home. I'm gonna go grab my cider.
Oh, right.
Are you coming back? Are you going back to the car?
Are you coming back? Inside?
This is gonna be great. We are on the move here.
So, are you going back to your car? Are you staying in the house?
Well, that's where the alcohol is.
Okay, I was just curious.
So, walking through my apartment complex.
I have a full dill pickle inside my drink.
Ew. Oh, that's so gross, Jeff.
But it's not even that gross because when they're sealed like that, there's not even flavor leaking. It's
Oh, yes, I know, but it is. There's
normally, pickles. Normally I'd be eating it by now, but that's not podcast appropriate.
Yeah, no.
No, I'm going to leave it in there.
Oh, I'm going to go. That smells good. Dude, here. Sounds delicious. Okay, I'm grabbing my cider now. All right.
Oh,
and they're not even a sponsor yet.
Right. Yeah, it's Stella Cedra.
Cedra.
Now
they're definitely not going to be a sponsor. Right.
It's cider spelled fancy.
Yeah, it's Cedra. Okay. Oh, here it is. Oh, here we go. This is awesome. I'm having a great time. Give me one second.
Okay.
Take
your time.
Kristen, is Cedra French? Cedra?
Well, it'd be like Cedre if it was French.
Cedre.
Well, so what's the proper explanation? Oh, you're not even Canadian. How do you know that?
I took French in high school.
Oh, you're from Seattle.
I took 4 years and I know nothing.
Oh my God.
Accent aigu. Yeah.
Accent aigu. I know. I've had the words sac à dos stuck in my head all day because at work today, we were talking about un sac à dos, which is your backpack. What's in your backpack? And then there was lots of conversation about just using the word sac because it was a great French class.
Because then it makes the kids giggle.
You're definitely a Canadian.
It made me giggle. It definitely, when I can help.
You have the boot.
Yes.
Yeah, I heard a little boot there.
Yeah.
We were number one independent film in Canadian iTunes for a little bit.
Ah, that's awesome. We got a lot of fans up here.
Canada's been really great to me.
Can you see, like, when you see demographics or analytics or whatever, can you see where you're most, like, bought or downloaded or that sort of thing for the film, like, location-wise, other than just Canada, I mean?
For the most part, I have to go... I can drill down. I have a lot of analytics on everything that we... I have a marketing background, so I definitely know how to do all those things and run the ad managers, and I have like analytics on all my websites and things like that. No, I don't use it as in depth as some people. You can really get in depth, so I just use it for basic to kind of see where things are, where traffic is coming from and things like that. Canada's a big one. It's like US, Canada, Germany, the UK. No, I take that back. It's Canada, Australia, the UK.
Wow.
Australia is really, and bless their hearts, they have to pay so much to get anything. So for a Blu-ray, to get a Blu-ray, to buy it from me, it's $17.99. But the shipping is $13. Mm-hmm. If you get a shirt with that, the shipping is $27.
Oh.
Yeah. That's like living in Canada. That's the same thing. Exchange, shipping.
Oh. No, but and you know, but what I noticed. Hi. What I noticed, I was originally charging. I was charging an arm and a leg. Like all international was charging the same. And then when I started doing my shipping, I realized that like the basic shipping to Canada is like $3 or $4. So I went and changed all my Canadian pricing, shipping pricing, and dropped it all down. I didn't refund everybody's money, but
that's funny because like when I buy stuff and get like, I'm not going to, so I bought, just for example, off topic, I bought two bathing suits from an American company the other day.
Right.
So not only did I have to pay the exchange, but then I got an email today saying I had to pay duty. And so like two bathing suits ended up costing me like $250.
Dang, I don't know how that works with the movies. People have been getting it. I don't know if they have to pay a duty.
Maybe no, it's like physical, like if it's coming to your house or your door or whatever.
Oh, right, but if the DVD or Blu-ray does.
Oh yeah, yeah. You're right. Right.
I wonder. Yeah. I have to ask. I've seen people have been getting them and they haven't been complaining. So
overall, how is the response? Are you really excited with how people?
Oh my gosh, I'm a very lucky human being. I definitely busted my butt, but to have the, like this last month, I did a thing where I did a free signed poster with any order,
mm-hmm.
and I had a really strong month. So much that I'm backed up a little bit. People are like, hey, I ordered 2 weeks ago, where's my thing? And I'm like, I am doing the best I can, I'm one dude. And like, we had a whole lot of orders come in. I mean, I had like, I don't want to give specific numbers, but a few hundred just this month, and that's really good. That's not counting like the online digital sales or our distributors that do Amazon and Best Buy and all that stuff. That's just direct sales from me, like, right. You know, right. Where like I'm shipping it, you know, I'm doing the whole thing. So that was really good because I wasn't sure how it was going to be after Christmas. And we still have a little way about another year and a half of hopefully this kind of this, if it can stay this steady for the next year and a half, we can hopefully recoup. So it's
that's really cool.
It's fairly expensive to make movies,
mm-hmm.
which I did not know going into it.
Right. Are Mike and Aaron really excited about how it turned out?
I think so. Mike was for sure. No, they both liked the movie for sure. Like Aaron thought it was great. We did a screening in San Francisco, and she hadn't seen it until then,
because
mm-hmm. she was a little apprehensive at first. Because like some guys telling the story of your life and your family, some random guy that you've never met and you have no idea what his intentions are or his sensibilities or. So the fact that they let me even continue on and gave me the stuff they gave me and Aaron doing the interview is, I mean, it speaks to the label, you know, it's like, I don't know if you can do that with almost anything. And Mike was really great. I think Mike has I think he likes to put things in, set things up and then see how they play out. So he's like, I'll give you the interview and like, I was trying to turn that down and not turn it off. This is the worst ever. I'm screwing this up so bad.
it's okay. We won't edit it out.
Good. So, but no, Mike was real. And I've probably told the story a million times, but hopefully your listeners have never heard me say it. He told me we were making it. He's like, listen, I don't mind if you do it. It's cool. But I think it's going to be boring, dude. There's not a lot of story there. And I was like, okay, well, that's your opinion. I think I could, And he kind of was on that tip for a long time. And then he sent me when I sent him the final version, he sent me an email and was basically like, I was wrong. You were right. This is great. Entertaining, it's awesome. I think he said something along the lines of like, you had more creative vision than I had in regards to this.
Wow.
And he's like, and that's really rare.
Yeah.
So so like it was he's normally a one or two sentence guy most in emails, and this was like a three paragraph email. He references the fact that it's a three paragraph email in the email saying, I do not write this much. So So that was definitely validating. And then a little bit later, I got to show Aaron, and she said it was great. I handled everything. And one of the other things that I thought was really validating was Bridget Sly.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to make sure I sent her the news for names section to because I needed to get permission to use the pictures of the kids and things like that. And she watched it, and she said she showed it to the girls, and they laughed and they cried. And like,
awesome.
I'm about to tear up right now. No, because it was, I mean, from an outsider, that's not my family, my friends, and how I treated it, like, I wanted to be very careful how I treated it and make sure it was respectful, and people got a sense of how important he was in that family, so, mm-hmm. and apparently I did it, so, that was very cool to have that response.
for me, like the best, it was funny because so I was watching it and I was texting a couple people and Kristen and I were like having a conversation about it and my husband and stuff. And when I turned it on, I got in bed and I was watching it and I was like, within the first 5 minutes, I was like, I'm so fucking pumped right now. Like, I was like, I was ready to just kind of like cruise through it, watch it, lay in bed. And I was like, oh my God. Like the film was so nostalgic for me in so many ways.
Right.
I was like, oh my God, I haven't heard that song for a while. And Kristen and I have this kind of ongoing joke with each other that we still listen to the same music we were listening to in like 1997, 1996, yeah. Like our old favorites. Mm-hmm. And so watching the movie, it was just like, oh my God, it got me super excited. And I like told a whole bunch of friends, I was like, you have to watch it because you're going to watch it in the first 5 minutes. You're going to be like, oh my God, I remember like driving around in your car in high school doing laps, like smoking weed, doing nothing. And, you know, that was the soundtrack. So for me, it was super nostalgic to watch in that way. And I loved that part about it.
120 songs in the movie.
Wow.
Really?
120. You don't feel it. You don't feel it because we really like a lot of it is background. Those 120, but there's like in the part where Mike is talking about his drug use and things like that. We have like I'm an alcoholic song going on it. You know, like he's like I'm a blah 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 alcoholic. So all the songs are like if you're listening are definitely relevant. And it was cool to get to use like. Like the anti-manifesto kicks in at the intro. And like, it's funny because I was just hanging out with Rhodey from Protest the Hero. He's the guy who has that line going right. You know Protest, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And I was like, he's like, he hadn't seen the movie yet. He's like, oh, I'm a little nervous. I know I'm in it. I was like, dude, you have like some of the best, you get like the best line. Cause then you, like, when you say that, you say Anime Manifesto, that song kicks in, and then like people are like, "Yes," you're like, "Fuck yes," well, and then
that's true.
Go ahead. Wait.
I was just gonna say, so with Propagandhi, like Less Talk, More Rock is probably in my top three favorite albums
of all time.
I don't get sick of it. I play it in my car. I sing to it. I like the spoken word. And then so after I watched the movie, Kristen, I don't know if you saw this or not, but I tweeted. And like tagged Propagandhi and they like responded to me and then I like was super excited about it. And they're pretty awesome with their fans on Twitter and stuff like that. They almost always respond. But I was literally watching your movie and I was like, yes, and I like got inspired to make a tweet and then they responded and I took a screenshot.
Oh nice. I sent it to me. I want to see it.
I will, because it's just, it was another one of those nostalgic things. And I think that's what I said in my tweet about it being, like, one of the most nostalgic voices, you know, in terms of, like, the spoken word on Less Talk, More Rock and stuff.
Oh, yeah, like, prop up or bring down governments.
Totally. It was awesome.
Speaking of Propagandhi, though, I'm wondering, you can't really tell the Fat Wreck story without getting into that part. About Mike and Propagandhi, but was there any thought about not including it, or were you hesitant to talk to either party about it?
We interviewed Propagandhi twice so we could get more of their side, and then they were too polite, and like, I'm sure the version you saw, it's really funny, because we did our theatrical run starting in April, we did film festivals and like did like 70 or 80 screenings around the world. And everyone saw a different movie than what's on the Blu-ray. Slightly different. Because that, the one on the Blu-ray, it was, like, I was talking to Chris. And he was like, yeah, I wish we would have said that. You know, I wish it would have been more. I was like, you can say that. Mm-hmm. Record something right now and send it to me tomorrow. And so he did, and when he provided a little more context, because I was like, I wish I said this, and I was like, don't wish, say it. Like, and so I sent him these questions, like, what was your criticism of the punk voter movement, and what was your criticism of Mike? And like, lay it out, like, you know, for real, like, be legit. Mike is straight up, don't be polite, tell what you really feel, because like, in the editing, we're going to be able to, you know, give each side, you know. So he did that, and then it was just audio, so I was like, how am I going to do this? And so we ended up taking the puppets made by Jenny Cotter of Bad Cop, Bad Cop.
Jenny made those?
Yeah.
Yeah, you didn't know that?
Oh, I didn't know that.
Oh.
I have a serious girl crush on Jenny. Oh, my God.
Yeah, she has so many talents.
I have a person crush on her. I want that to sound completely platonic. I think she's an amazing human being. Right. Like I have that kind of crush, not a romantic crush, but a platonic crush, because she's so talented and so like, she's really great to work with. Really, the puppets were her idea, mm-hmm. and not necessarily for in the context that we use them in the whole thing, and we worked together to get the right mix of puppets that we needed. But she's like, hey, because we were filming. It's funny because we were at that show with Bomb Pops and Bad Cop, Bad Cop. Mm-hmm. And afterwards, I was talking to her about an animator, because I don't know how much you know about her, but she's used to work for Titmouse doing backgrounds for Metalocalypse, that show Metalocalypse, mm-hmm. you know, like drawing the backgrounds.
What mm-hmm. can she do?
And then she also did the murals in the courtroom on Parks and Recreation.
Oh, I didn't know that one.
I didn't know that until like after we had already done the puppets and the movie was already coming. I was like, what?
Wow.
So she said she can't, we were talking about animators and she's like, yeah, I can hook you up with animators. Like, have you thought about puppets? Like, I make puppets. And she showed me an example of something she had made. And I was like, this is it. Oh my gosh. This is like the thing, you know, a very organic way of being definitely different. Mm-hmm. It gave a huge amount of flexibility for us to shoot little puppet scenes, because, you know, it took maybe two or three of us and we didn't have to like get an actor or anything like that. We could manipulate the puppets however we wanted. And that being said, tying it into the Propagandhi story, so Chris sends me the audio, and so I'm like, and some of it's fairly harsh. Mm-hmm. You know, saying it was like Mike's vanity project and all these kind of, like, I'm not sure what version you saw. Like, if you saw the one that's online, iTunes, then you saw this version. Like, the one that got released has this section in it. And it's just okay. It's really like two sentences. But what we did is I took that and I took the puppet, Chris, and basically have him, you know, back and forth with Mike. So anytime it's really harsh, it's the puppets kind of talking to each other. Mm-hmm. And so we recorded Mike, and it was the first time in the movie that we had, like, all the other times the puppets were kind of, like, reenacting. Mm-hmm. And this was a little different because it was the puppets themselves being interviewed. So we actually kind of ended up with a little bit different section. It ended up being the most complicated puppet section of the movie. And, you know, so, and we did that 2 weeks before we had to send out the Blu-rays.
Oh, wow.
So I made those changes, and you know, so you know, it's never done. It's never done until it's done. So which was great because it added so much context and added this great puppet section to it. And yeah, it was those guys are great, man. The Propagandhi guys are really awesome. I don't think I know. I think I know where I fall on that debate. I think the punk voter thing was important. I think that was an important thing to do to get kids involved and paying attention. And even though it didn't last as a movement itself, the kids who got involved in that, there's a good chance a lot of those continued on investigating, or at least had a certain awareness mm-hmm. of the political situation, I mean, which is a huge thing. So I don't think Mike did it as a vanity project either. I think he was pretty genuine in his disgust of what was happening politically and wanted to do something about it and had a platform that he could use. And
he said in the movie, he said, like, I don't like doing interviews. Like, I don't like doing this shit, but I'm out here and I'm, you know, talking about it and that sort of thing. So I didn't actually know about that. I mean, I'm in Canada, right? So,
right.
So I actually didn't know any of that story. So I was
That was great.
Right. So
That makes me so happy.
Yeah, so I totally learned that in the show, and Propagandhi being one of my, you know, favorites. And from Winnipeg, Canadian,
Well, Propagandhi is my favorite band. Like,
really?
Hands down. Like, no, okay. Hands down. That's like, I probably listen to more Propagandhi than I do any other Fat Records band. So I really, I guess I'm more of an Epitaph fan.
I got to see Propagandhi for the first time in my life just last year.
What?
Yeah. And it was like kind of a bucket list show for me. Timing worked out. And
no, so I know how that goes. Yeah. I once drove 14 hours up to Minnesota to see Propagandhi play. That's a 28 hour drive round trip.
Do you want to hear my most extreme trip to see a band?
No.
Because I live in the middle of
yes. Totally shut it down. Yes, I totally do.
Okay, so last year, Kristen knows this, is I flew to California. I'd never traveled by myself. I'd never flown anywhere by myself. I had never been to California. And I based my trip solely on staying with people I knew on the internet.
That's always safe.
So I literally flew in California into John Wayne, and I waited for the person to pick me up, and I went to her house, and it was pretty extreme, but it was a weekend of, it turned out amazing. It couldn't have been any better, but.
What band was it?
Face to Face.
Oh, nice. Trevor, you know, I got a good story about them if you want to hear it.
See, that was my,
that's one of our questions.
And it was also going to be my critique.
Yeah. Oh, what was your critique?
There's not enough because I'm even wearing a Face to Face shirt right now.
Nice.
And I feel like every fucking podcast we do, people are going to be like, here she goes again talking about Face to Face. But it's true. They're my diehard. Right. And so in the movie, when it came up, I was like, there is not enough, and it's just Trevor. There's nobody else, and there was no footage or videos or anything.
Okay, let's hear Shaun's.
Okay, go. I'm trying.
No, it's that. I mean, that's fair enough. But like I said, we couldn't focus on all the bands.
So I know. I know.
But Trevor denied us two times. We kept asking him. He kept saying no. He didn't like the first trailer. From what I later found out, and it wasn't cut by me, it was cut by this other guy who, really talented guy, but is not in this, doesn't understand the punk rock thing, you know? And our big trailer I cut, and when he saw that, and our motion graphics guy was working with him on some stuff, and he was like, you're not gonna do this movie, dude? He's like, you're working on that? And then he contacted me. We actually did his interview here in Dallas. He was down here doing some recording. Trevor was. And that's why, you know, his interview was really great. I wish he would have done it sooner. But I still don't think he would have had much more actual face-to-face. It was more I wanted to get his perspective rather than it being. Because remember, the movie's about Fat Records. It's not about the band per se. So even when we go through the first five Fat bands, if you notice the stories that we're telling are stories in relation to the band, like how they got signed or like a funny, quirky thing that might have happened, but in connected to the record label, if it makes sense. Mm-hmm. So so you want to make sure we're not telling the whole story of Lagwagon. We have 7 or 8 minutes. We're going to tell who's Lagwagon, what do they sound like, and do we have a personal story that connects them to the label.
And it makes sense because Trevor's the only founding member, you know,
right.
The only guy that's been there start to finish. It's his band from start to finish kind of thing. So it makes sense that you had him, but I was being a fickle.
No, it's awesome. I love that each fan has like their own, like where they're all like, how come you didn't have not enough yada yada or whoever. No, I had a bunch of people tell me that. I'm like, well, every band gets some type of screen time because we have that layout of all those records, which we purposely, a lot of thought was how we laid those out so you could see each band. And then also the list that shows the generations. Mm-hmm. So at some point, either their band name, an album cover, or they get a reference. At some point, every band that's been on Fat is somehow in the movie.
That's awesome.
And even if it's more of a subconscious level and not like in your face, the kind of thing. So, and I mean, you know, that's the thing about make, especially documentaries, like there's so much, like we did 130 interviews. And like, there's some guys that have like one or two lines and we have these great full interviews. Like they gave great stuff, but just, you know, it didn't really, they weren't as relevant because they weren't as close to the main people or that kind of thing. And it's really kind of finding what the story is and finding all those things is like, I mean, I could take the same stuff I shot and make probably a little bit different movie, you know, make another movie out of it, mm-hmm. depending on the choices that we make. So, but you got to make choices. We had an overall structure that we wanted to hit, and then you have to make choices and be confident. I think that's one thing about being director, from what I've read and understood, is you got to be able to make decisions and make choices. And most creative work, you have to like,
edit.
You have to like say, yeah. Okay, this is it. Does this serve the story? Is this going to serve the thing? Like, you know, it's also because it's a fan film. How much do we cater to the fans directly, and how much do we cater to an outside audience, so that we can? I mean, my goal wasn't just to make a movie for Fat Records fans, which of course, you know, because let's be honest. I could have made anything. I could have made a shit movie. Like all the Fat Records fans were gonna see it, at least for the first time. At least once.
Right.
True.
But then they tell everyone that it was shit.
Right. But but still, people would probably go see for themselves to see how shit it was. If you're a Fat Records fan, you're watching this movie.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so my goal was to make sure, like, people from outside of it could understand why us have stuck with it for 25 years. And why it's still, like, why when you see another Fat Records fan or you see another, like one of those bands, someone wearing a band shirt like that, you see a Propagandhi shirt on somebody, you know you can connect with that person right away. And that happens all around the world. And so I wanted to be able to showcase that. But if it was all inside baseball, the mm-hmm. term, mm-hmm. then you don't get people who might have never been exposed to it to understand why it was important and why it was important in our lives, but also potentially be like, these bands sound great. I would like to know more about them. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And grow the attention toward it, because I think it's such a rare thing. I mean, I've worked in the music industry at some level for the past, like, you know, 15 years, and like, not everyone's like that. It's such a rare thing mm-hmm. to find someone who doesn't do contracts and treats people right and pays them on time and like it like treats people like family and not like a commodity, you know. Mm-hmm. And I think it's important to show that you can be successful, ethical, and kind for the most part, you know, and honest, and still be successful, especially right now, especially after what just happened last year, and where it seems like, oh, if you want to be, you just have to be the worst human being in the world, and you can, you know, get to the highest place in the land. And I just like, I don't know. It gives me hope. And I hope that other people see that. Like
you did a great job of getting that message across, for sure.
I agree.
Yeah. Do you think you'll do any more punk documentaries? Never. Never again.
No, that's not true. I'm trying to convince the Propagandhi guys to let me do a documentary about them. Awesome. I really feel like that's relevant right now with the alt-right and the kind of Nazi stuff that's popping up now. Totally. A lot of their early years were spent really literally fighting Nazis, like mm-hmm. literally. Like that riot I was telling you about, like Nazi had showed up or something. Mm-hmm. Nazis used to show up to their shows and skinheads and all that kind of stuff. And so I'm trying to convince Chris. He's like, no one wants to watch that. I was like, everybody wants to watch
that.
Yeah, we do.
Like, everybody wants to watch. If I announced that we were doing a Propagandhi documentary, everyone would be like, fuck yes.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I'm not, like, I'm taking, like, this year, I mean, mostly it's kind of, like, wrapping up all the stuff for the movie and making sure it sells so we can recoup. I got some irons in the fire, but I'm trying, I consider myself, I mean, it's going to sound so pretentious. Mm-hmm. consider myself a filmmaker, and I wanted to go to great lengths to let people know, like, I'm not like a, I wasn't like a punk rock fan, like a Fat Records fan that decided to make a movie. I was a guy wanting to make a movie, and I chose Fat Records as my subject because I thought it had a lot of the, it was important to me. I was passionate about it, and I felt there was a lot that wasn't being, that story wasn't being told about punk rock. Mm-hmm. All the other documentaries are like The Decline of Western Civilization or even Salad Days, and those documentaries are like how punk is violent and like how, like, you know, those 80s years is so much focused on like the Henry Rollins stuff, and that's not, nothing against it, it's just not what I, my experience, like, I just cannot, my experience was like, I call it neo-hippie. That, like, the, like, that mentality, like, because all those guys grew up with that bullshit, and there was no documentaries, like, about, like, what I had seen, so, I don't know, I do want to make another music documentary, mm-hmm. but I want to make sure that I don't get pigeonholed into that, that's my thing, so I want to branch out into some other little areas, and I got some other things in the works I can't speak to directly, but it's not necessarily, not, it's not in the punk rock world.
Okay.
But not that I have anything against it. I just, you know.
Right.
It's got, I'm hoping I can establish a career doing this. Mm-hmm. And doing that, I want to show that I can tell stories, whatever the story is. And that's one of the things, like, when we got the money from the crowdfunding, I was like, I need to do anything and everything I can do. Like, any ideas I have, that even if they're hard, to do them and put everything I can into telling a good story, a funny story, because humor was a big part of it. And something that's like people hadn't seen before, especially with so many documentaries coming out, you know what I mean? And I guarantee you, I would say I would put like at least $200 down to bet that there has never been a documentary that has a puppet being spanked by a dominatrix.
With a ball gag. Didn't he have a ball gag in his mouth at the time?
Yes. Yeah. I would say that, like, we have cornered that market.
Oh, my God. Yeah, the ball gag in the puppet was my favorite. Yeah.
Yeah, like, that was a real dominatrix that was doing the spanking thing. But, you know, like, so, yeah. So, I'm not sure if that answered the questions. I think I might have got off track there, but.
No, that was perfect, because we wanted to ask what you had coming up, too. So, that's perfect.
Yeah, I'm gonna, I'll see how this year plays out. I started driving Lyft.
Oh.
Like about 8 weeks ago, and
wait, man, what's Lyft? What's driving,
like,
Lyft?
Like Uber?
Yeah, similar to Uber. It's similar to Uber, but.
Oh, do you have that?
No.
In Canada? No.
We don't. We're not allowed to have Uber.
You don't have the ride sharing stuff yet?
No. They've tried to do it and they got shut down like ASAP.
Yeah, the taxi cab guys. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, those, yeah, screw those guys.
Yeah.
Those guys can't be fired if they're crappy. They usually have a union. And yeah, that's BS. That's not consumer friendly.
I agree.
And also it supplements so well a public transportation system. Mm-hmm. It's in the area I live. But my point of that, sorry, mm-hmm. tangent, is that it's a great way to network too, because I'm meeting so many different people and I'm making money, but I've also have a few more projects that it came from giving rides and having conversations. And
oh, like, wow. That's really cool.
So yeah, it's been really great. It's been super great.
That's a documentary in itself. Like,
I have a few stories. There's a guy that I'm going to talk to him on an ongoing basis. I don't know if it'll turn into, it'll be something small and short kind of thing, but this guy I picked up, he's going to be a basketball player, but he's ended up selling drugs or something and lost his scholarship and all this stuff, which is kind of a stereotypical basketball player. He's a really tall guy, you know, he mm-hmm. lost it. But then he was telling me he's got a 9-year-old son and he's only known him for 5 months because he got a call out of the blue saying, hey, your son's about to go into foster care. Do you want to take him? And he was like, I didn't know I had a son. And so they did the blood test and he took him in like right away. No questions asked. He's like, of course I'm going to do that. And he's a black guy and it's so like counter narrative to the stereotype you have, especially in the United States where like black men abandon their children. Mm-hmm. And here's a guy who's like, never met this 9-year-old kid. and was like, screw that. No, he's not going to foster care. I'm going to take care of him. And he had such a great soul. And he was telling me about how much, like the effort he's putting into, he has two daughters too. Mm-hmm. And I was like, hey, and then they've been together for 5 months. Wow. So I was like, hey, would you want to let me talk to you on film and, you know, kind of document this experience you're having, like, as your relationship grows? You know, 5 months is really fresh. So, like, mm-hmm. what will it be in a year? Like, what will it be? And, like, he has a real strong relationship with his father, which is very, you know. That's an example of, like, this is a guy I gave a ride to. And, like, I was like, this is a really great story, you know? So, I mean, who knows what'll come up. I'm really open. The last 2 or 3 years, I've been so hyper-focused on the movie where every day till like sometimes 6 or 7 in the morning doing editing sessions and just all the different aspects of the movie. And it's been my entire everything for the past, other than my daughter, of course. and the movie allowed me to stay home with her and so we have a really great relationship. But so now I'm just kind of like, I've been stuck in the house, not stuck, but you know, behind the screen. So now the Lyft thing is I'm making money from it, because when you make a movie, it takes time for all that the revenue to come backwards. I'm just trying to pay off the debt first. Mm-hmm. So I have money coming in, but also I have this thing where I'm meeting different people and I'm outside of my bubble. I'm seeing different parts of the cities. I'm having conversations and having at least, like, you know, getting to spend 20 or 30 minutes sometimes with people from vastly different walks of life. So, like, for instance, I'll give you a good example. One night, around 3 a.m., I took a couple to a XXX sex shop. The next morning, I took a little old lady to church.
Oh, wow. See?
Yeah. So it's like
my life in a nutshell.
I've taken a guy that's this high priced lawyer, probably makes way more than I'll ever think about, and I've taken staff, like, people home from a cashier at Kroger. Right. You know what I mean? Like, so it, for me, like, I'm just open right now to seeing what can happen. And
when you strike me as someone that can talk with anyone, that can just, like, you can talk with all these different people and find something interesting in their story. And I think that's really cool.
It's been really great. It's, I really like, right. I'm a people person, if you will.
Human interest.
So it's really, I love hearing what people's, like, the thing that they're doing. And, you know, I've been a psychiatrist chair to a lot of people as well. Right. Like when they're having a rough time, you know, venting and wanting to, you know, especially guys when their girlfriend's doing something.
Yeah.
That would be
it's been really great. I really like doing it. It's opening up a some opportunities and doors. And so, like, I don't know what the next thing is specifically, mm-hmm. but I am, allowing myself to see what's going to happen.
Awesome.
So I'm pretty stoked. I couldn't be more. And also I have under my belt this movie.
Yeah.
So, like, when people are like, oh, what do you do? I'm like, I make movies, you know? And that's always like, well, really? Yeah. Well, I make movie.
We make podcasts.
Yeah.
Podcast. I make podcasts.
I make podcasts.
Yeah.
So, it's been a great experience. I've actually, it's not too much to say this on the thing, but we premiered at the Dallas International Film Festival last year. And that was our world premiere. And this year, I'm going to be the social media coordinator for the festival. So they actually hired me on because like I said, I have a background in marketing, and we were promoting our movie.
Oh my gosh, what are your rates? We really need someone to help us with our social media and marketing.
Jeez. Oh gosh.
We'll talk later.
I make podcasts help.
No, We'll talk about that.
I was mostly kidding. We wouldn't bother you with that.
No, but I can give you some ideas and some tips and some ways. I can I would be more than willing to share some knowledge that I have with you so you guys can get on the right track as far as getting some attention toward the stuff. Awesome. So, yeah, we can talk about that later. The marketing thing really helped with the movie. I mean, being able to, I did the marketing plan for the movie when it was our distributor, and they told me it was the most detailed marketing plan they'd ever gotten. Most filmmakers have no idea about that stuff.
How to do that.
So, yeah. So I had a leg up in that regard. So, yeah. And I think, you know, it's a mark, you know, I think the movie, if I get it in front of a Fat Records fan, they're going to want to see it. And so really it's a matter of figuring out a way to get in front of people and get the eyeballs going. But I really feel like the word of mouth is doing real well right now. Mm-hmm. I think because I heard our disc manufacturer, the one that does from manufacturer our Blu-rays, apparently the main guy there, they were in a meeting, and somebody was recommending the movie to him to see. And one of the guys, sales guy I work with, he was like, "We're making those." So he had no idea that they were even making the movie, and he was being recommended to him. So like, I was like, "Oh, I'm glad to hear that for sure."
You know, so what'd be really funny is like when your grandma calls you up or something and she's like, "Hey, Shaun, I heard about this DVD about punk rock and you should really check it out." And you're like, "Hey, I made that."
Yeah. You're like, "Oh, I've had a few friends that didn't realize that I was the one making it." And they were
That's what I mean. Yeah.
They're like, "Holy crap, this is great." Like, "Yeah, you're making that? You? You? I don't know. Is it going to be any good?"
So if people want to get the movie still, tell us where, so people listening know how to pay you.
As I said, I am a marketing guy. So yeah. One of the things I did was, because even inherent in the title is a few different things, if I can go into some detail here for a second. So it has a couple entendres. One, it's a fat wreck, which is a play on fat wreck chords, of course, right, as you know. But if you're looking at that have no idea about punk rock, you have no idea what this is, and you see a description of this movie, and it has puppets, and it says a fat wreck.
Yeah.
You're like, it has to cause a question in your head. Like, was there an accident? What happened? So, like, there's that side. Plus, Fat Records website is fatwreck.com. My website is afatwreck.com.
Perfect.
So if you go to afatwreck.com, it's like A Auger, you know, like oh my God. I'm gonna like in a thing I would be before them because it's a fat wreck.
Yeah.
So I'm afatwreck.com. On there are links to get it at, like, we're on iTunes and Amazon and internationally the Vimeo on demand. If you want to buy a Blu-ray, it links directly to my store. You can get the Blu-ray and DVD on Amazon.com, but obviously I recommend buying it for me directly because, one, I make more money because they take a, you know, there's a, you know,
big chunk.
It all gets split away. So you're actually helping support directly. Get it wherever you can get it. You know what I mean? If you can see it. And I'll say this. To any of you thinking about pirating it, well, don't pirate it. Send me an email. I'll send you a link if, like, you know what I mean?
If you really can't afford
it. If you can't afford the $5 to $10 to watch it, send me an email and I'll send you a screener. And, like, don't, no shame. It's okay. Yeah. Like, and... Awesome. Like, because I'd rather you get it from me for free rather than go on to one of those streaming sites where you're going to get spam on your computer. They're getting ad revenue from you watching my movie. So that money, even though you're watching it for free, they're getting paid and that money's going to them. And they don't discriminate what they advertise. They'll do whatever.
Yeah.
So.
And that's just nasty.
So sometimes porn and all kind of stuff. So. Like I said, if you're one of the, so inclined, if you're a BitTorrent guy, like, you know, I know how things are, you know what I mean? I go into the comment sections of the streaming sites cause I've been seeing them pop up and I've go into the comments and like, "Hey guys, please, you know, please support the film. My wife and daughter, thank you.
But that's awesome. Like, I think that that's something that, you know, it's invisible crime. Isn't that what they call it? That's invisible
crime. Yeah, but I mean, to be completely honest and forefront, you know, I've done it before. I've streamed stuff that I like, you know, I support now. So I have a vested interest. But what I mean is, like, you know, you take a risk when you do that. And I don't think, I'm just saying, you don't have to, because if you just ask me, I'll give it to
right.
you.
Right. And that's Shaun at openendedfilms.com.
Oh, crap.
Right?
Get a huge influx of emails.
You'll be fine. No.
No. Because then I have your emails.
My mom is going to email you and ask you for a screener, because she's going to be one of the listeners tonight.
Awesome.
My mom will email.
That's totally fine. So I send it to her. And then I'll send you an email later. It's like, hey, did you like the movie? Hey, for $5, you can get all the bonus stuff.
I asked my mom last week, Kristen was like, I was like, hey, mom, do you read Mabel Syndrome? And she didn't respond. And I had to send her another text. And I was like, it's okay to say no. I was just curious. And she's like, well, when you first started, I did, but I haven't for a really long time. I was like, that's cool. Like, I just wanted to know the answer. I was.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
totally.
Now I can.
No shame. I mean, everyone's got their thing. I get it.
Yeah.
Now I can talk about her on our podcast, and I know she's not listening.
Right. That's good. That's good. Yeah. She'll listen to.
A lot of our friends have already bought and watched A Fat Wreck, but if you haven't yet, please go to afatwreck.com and purchase the DVD or the Blu-ray, or stream the video from there.
Ooh. If you have seen the movie, and you guys too, please do this. Either go to iTunes. That's fine. Like, you go to iTunes, Kristen, because you're in the U.S. Mm-hmm. Jessica, you can go there too. But it's Canadian iTunes.
I'm not in North Korea.
No, but I won't see your comments. Because like, when you see, when in the U.S., you only see the U.S. store. In Canada, you only have the Canadian store. That's why we are the top independent film in Canada. But that's much harder than the U.S. because we were competing with like Ryan Gosling and all those, you know, independent films. Like, which means not a major studio did it, but still, like, La La Land is a independent movie. You know what I mean? Technically.
Yeah.
So we were, you know, so it's a little more challenging, but my point being, go and leave, if you liked it, please go leave a review.
Yeah.
And if you are so inclined, IMDb, any place where you can review, go review it. And that helps other people find, like, leave an actual review, not just rate it, but leave a review. That helps people find it, because it pushes us up the ranking. It really does help a whole lot. And also helps as we are the next phase, because you have your theatrical, and you have your release, your physical and digital release. And when you do your digital, you have what's called, you know, it's video on demand, you know, where you pay for it. The next stage is subscription video on demand, which is like your Amazon video, not instant, but Amazon Prime video or whatever. And then you're like, what you call it, like Netflix and things like that. So, so please leave reviews.
Yeah, awesome. Our listeners will definitely leave reviews. Thank you so much, Shaun. That was so nice of you to talk with us for so long.
Oh my gosh, how long has it been? I didn't even check.
Kristen.
Hour 20.
Okay, that's pretty good. Very good.
That's awesome. Thank you very much.
No, thank you guys. Thank you for the interest in the movie. Thank you for having me on the show. I wish we had talked a little more about the woman stuff. Because, like, one of the things that I really, it took me 11 months to convince Aaron to do an interview. And I really,
one of my questions, but we didn't get to it, is how, I heard that she was very hesitant and very shy, and I want to know how you actually convinced her.
I swear, well, it's kind of like, it wasn't me, it was Mike and Vanessa. They were like, hey, this thing's happening, and if you're not in it, that's going to be super weird.
Yeah.
Like, it's happening. And that's basically my philosophy. force people into doing the things by just sheer momentum.
Well, maybe we can have you on again to talk about the women's stuff.
Part two.
I would love to, because I would love to, because, like, punk rock for so long was such a such a boys club, and to have like this big record label really have someone behind the scenes that was a big part of the label, that was you know, was a woman doing a lot of the work, you know, doing like the on the business side a lot of heavy lifting. So it was really important to have her in the movie, like, and tell that story, say, hey, look, you dorks, punk rock has always been like, you know, across genders, like, I'm glad what's happening with that, like the Bomb Pops and bad cop, and you're getting this like the shift, not just there, you got War on Women and like all these bands that are starting to like girls are women are starting to play like the music that I like,
right?
Because it's not that I don't like female fronted bands. It's like they're not like I like Propagandhi, so I like War on Women because here you have like, you know, a female fronted band, and the music they're playing is totally badass.
It's you
know,
true. It's,
you know, and so like, and I think War on Women is like the spiritual successor to Propagandhi, you know, for sure.
Kristen's the one behind Mabel Syndrome. I just somehow fell into a lucky hole.
And that's not true.
A lucky hole?
No.
A lucky hole.
I fell into Kristen's lucky hole. I love her lucky hole. And it's true.
That is not true. But anyways, yeah.
It is true. And so I got to be part of this, but it's Kristen and I have only met in person once in real life.
Right.
You know, she's in Boston, I'm in Canada. We're not on the same fucking continent. So
someone needs to get her a map.
So I mean, we could talk, honestly, we could talk for hours. Kristen and I have like, you know, how many blogs drafted and saved and trying to get our point across, but you know, like we just did a post on Facebook earlier this week, and
yesterday? No, yeah, I don't know.
And it was our top post that we've ever done, and it reached all these people, and it was just a simple sign of like some. What did it say? Support women in punk rock.
Yeah.
And like people were sharing it like crazy and tagging all these bands and musicians that they loved. And it was so, so rad to see. So
women are more punk rock now.
Totally.
They're the punk rock. Cause like, it's like back when Propagandhi was doing their thing, they were kind of, you know, it's the dudes calling out all the injustice kind of stuff. Right. Mm-hmm. But now it's like the women who have experienced it are the ones being like, fuck this. Like, fuck that. I'm ready to fucking rebel. And, like, they're more punk rock than any white, straight, cisgender dude can be.
Okay, like, so can we say, Chris and I know we've been talking for an hour and a half, and our four listeners are probably long gone.
Out. Yeah.
What? I hope not. I thought it was highly entertaining.
My mom gave... No, it's not you, trust me. But no.
Mom had to go to bed. No.
Yeah. Totally. So, a main thing that we've talked about it in interviews and we've talked about it in blogs, and Chris and I have conversations all the time, is this line between being a fucking fan of punk rock as a female and like loving the music and supporting the bands you love and going to the live shows and being labeled as a fucking groupie who's just there to fuck somebody. And you know, most people, I would say most men don't realize, that's a generalization, but people don't realize exactly what that means and how heavy that is. Like, that we're constantly thought, we were not considered to be as big of a fan as a guy, ever.
Right.
Ever.
And our intentions are always questioned, whereas
always.
Guys are, don't have to face that question ever.
Right. When when you go up after the show to meet, talk with the band, a guy does it. It's like, oh, he likes that band or he wants to talk with the guy. A girl does it like, oh, she's trying to fuck that guy.
100%.
Totally. Every time.
And every single time. And it's the most, I mean, demeaning, infuriating, upsetting thing. And that's,
but girls are going to take, it's going to, like, when my, what I hope for is by the time in the next, you know, 12 to 13 years, by the time my daughter is starting to go to shows, that it's not like they don't say a female fronted band. They just say a band. We're going to go see a band. And it's like, and when you go to a show, you see a diversity, and where it's not like, where it's not commented on.
Right.
If that makes sense. Like where it's not, it's when she goes to that show, it's already been, it's all she's known is that girls play punk rock. That's all she's known. Is that, that's how it is. That's why I think it's so great, like, to have Bad Cop, which they play for her, and, like, I was saying, War on Women, but also what Propagandhi just did, bringing someone into that band is amazingly talented, but also shows, like, hey, we're not just all talk. You know how it is with diversity. You can't wait for diversity to come to you. You have to reach out and make it happen. You have to say, we are going to choose someone who is amazing and really can do the thing we need as far as the talent's concerned, but we're going to bring someone on that also has this other criteria, because from a visual standpoint, especially being Propagandhi, I am so stoked. Because I'm hoping that a whole generation of young women will see that and start making music like Propagandhi.
Right? It's so true. It's 100%
like, true. You have to see it. You have to be able to see it to, like, see that it's a thing. Like, you have to see that. And, like, so when, like, girls now are going to see young women are going to see that band, they're like, oh, I could do that. Mm-hmm. You know, like, and that's a really huge thing. I they were down here not too long ago. We hung out for a little bit, and I was telling them, I was like, man, I was so happy when you guys did that. I think that was one of the, and I, you know, because I've seen her play, they're amazing. She's amazing. Yeah. Like they didn't, like, it wasn't like, oh, we have to get a girl, so, you know, we'll pick a girl who's good. There are, I don't know if you've been on YouTube and seen some, like, of the guitar players out there right now, and dudes are in trouble, man. Dudes are in trouble.
Dude, girls are gonna take over.
They literally are. I mean, I'm hoping I can help bring it about, mm-hmm. for my, as much as I can. I want my daughter to, you know, grow up in a world where she can do whatever the fuck she wants to do.
Well, we're trying to do our part.
That's what we're trying to do. Exactly.
And that's why I think what you guys are doing is huge, because, like, there's a big cultural shift happening, and obviously we're seeing pushback a little bit, but it's inevitable. This is an inevitable thing. I mean, I don't mean inevitable, it's just going to happen. We have to fight for it, of course, mm-hmm. but it's
about time. It's the right time.
And there's more guys like me. There's a lot of guys like me. All my friends, like, and, you know, earlier in our youth, we were probably more chauvinistic, and, like, we become shook and woke.
Shook and woke.
Well, and I married someone who won't put up with that bullshit.
Exactly. Yeah.
And so, you know, it's forced me, from my wife, is, like, forced me to have to, like, kind of question some of these narratives that I have in my head. Mm-hmm. And that is, you know, that's challenging. That's hard to, like, break those things. But it takes effort, you know, and it takes someone like me and my friends, like, say, hey, man, I'm in a band and we just wrote this song, and it's kind of like about how, like, we have to kind of, like, we want to fight for a better world for our daughters, because we both have daughters, but we also have to recognize our, when we were younger, the way we were treating young girls, you know, when we were, like, high school and, like, mm-hmm. you know, being a dude and, like, you know, wanting to, like, you know, sleep around, and girls were, like, you know, more objects than they were,
you
know.
Well, you can't change until you kind of reflect on the past and reflect on your behavior.
Right.
And then you can make change.
So we're in that, like, I'm, you know, I've been shook or whatever, like, the young people with the terms. But, I mean, it's been quite a few years now. But, you know, it's still, like, you know, me and my wife will talk about this kind of stuff all the time. And, I purposely wanted to marry someone that was not going to be we're going to get married, and married is an institution that clearly has its roots in some very sexist things, but I don't see it as the traditional kind of marriage as, like, she's my property kind of thing. Uh-huh. It's more, and we have a very, like, our gender, we have
Uh-oh, did we lose him?
He'll come back. It was a heavy topic to I know, interrupted on. I wonder if he can hear us.
I don't know.
Is this a good opportunity for me to take a bite of the pickle that was in my drink?
Sure.
Because I already
make a lot of crunching.
I'll take my microphone off, but I'm not gonna lie. I already took one bite and I hit it.
Oh yeah. Off camera, you took a bite of your pickle.
I did.
Thank you for doing that off camera.
You're welcome. Okay.
So I think he's gone.
I feel like he's gone.
Yeah.
You know what though? I feel like we're gonna.
He is gone.
Oh, he is gone. He just left. Okay, but that's cool. You know what we're gonna do? We're gonna do part two.
Totally.
We're gonna do part two and
continued discussion with Shaun Colon.
Yeah, that was pretty awesome. That was great.
Yeah.
So, everybody, thanks for listening. And Shaun, no matter where you are right now, thanks for doing this episode tonight because that was super rad. And I can't wait for part two.
Go to afatwreck.com and buy the DVD or Blu-ray. It's worth it. You'll love it.